13-day trip.
You had your own Sunday show to go on, but Donna Brazile chose to go on This Week with George Stephanopoulos. I want to get your reaction to her statement about her book that talks about the division between the Democratic Party and Hillary Clinton's camp and how she was treated. Listen.
For those who are telling me to shut up, they told Hillary that a couple of months ago. You know what I tell them? Go to hell. I'm going to tell my story. I want to tell my story, George. And I say go to hell because why am I supposed to be the only person that is unable to tell my story?
But there's so many things that she brought up, one of which was that Hillary Clinton, she was contemplating replacing Hillary Clinton after her 9/11 wobble that Rick Leventhal reported on. Did you guys hear about that? Did you hear about her condition? And did you hear about a possible last-minute swap?
We had never heard of that. I don't think it would have mattered because President Trump just had the more economically optimistic message and was a natural connector to folks. And there was nothing that Biden and Booker, the alleged dynamic duo that was going to replace the very uninspiring Clinton-Kane ticket. We had never heard about that. But I want to just say something for the record once and for all. Whenever somebody says to me or one of my colleagues or indeed the president himself, why are you still talking about the election of a year ago? Why are you still talking about Hillary Clinton? Because they are talking about it. I'd be happy to never mention her again. Who? We beat her. I'm the woman who works in this place. She doesn't, but she's on this book tour. You've got Donna Brazile out there trying to clear her name and get the truth out there. And I respect Donna for doing that. Donna became the interim DNC chair about the same time became the Trump-Pence campaign manager. So I worked I worked alongside of her plenty. Mm-hmm. We've always had a respectful relationship. She's a smart woman. She feels like she's warning her Democratic Party to move on, to not be so smug and self-important and look at these elections as inevitable. I see this Virginia race tightening now for much the same reason for governor. But what Donna is saying that's not getting enough coverage, number one, that it was President Obama who left the Democratic Party bankrupted through neglect, had pushed all the donors practically to his outside group, so they had to replenish the coffers, that Hillary Clinton tried to rig the system and the election for her and lost anyway, that the Sanders voters were disenfranchised. He ended up with 13 million voters in 22 contests that he won. Anyway, it tells you what a terrible candidate she was. And then Donna Brazile did not like the way she was being treated, did not like the way that the down ballot races were neglected. And this is the Democratic Party still at odds with itself. They're fighting with each other. They're bereft of leadership, bereft of ideas. They've lost over 1,000 seats on President Obama's watch. But I thought her criticisms of both Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama, on top of her criticism of Debbie Wasserman Schultz, she referred to them as, quote, three titanic egos. They're talking about each other in a way that we're not.
Right. Did you know she said she approached your camp about a united front of with Russian meddling? Did that ever happen as far as you know? Did they get to your level, Kellyanne?
It did not. But I want to say something, that it was President Obama who had this information. And as far as I know, he didn't take it to us either. And then you see, again, in Donna's written works, she's talking about National Security Advisor Rice. And she's also talking about Attorney General Holder. And President Obama, they all knew about the Russian meddling and never told us why. They thought Hillary would win. And I guess maybe they were perhaps too embarrassed to admit that Russia was trying to meddle at the time on their watch. But we would have liked that information. The fact is, the reason nobody has me on TV right now to ask me about George Papadopoulos, ask me about Carter Page, I've never met these gentlemen. I don't know them. When I became campaign manager, the idea that I had to look any further than Hillary Clinton or the upper Midwest to win this election was foolishness. We had the better communicator. We had the superior message. And I don't know what these folks were doing in the primary, but it turns out that it's the Democrats who still have a Russia problem. And the president is right. People should take a look at that.
Well, somebody's speaking out on the Democratic side. It's Donna Brazile. Maybe she'll tell us
more. Good for
her. All right. Kellyanne, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, Kellyanne. Great to see you.
Take care.
Now, welcome back, Donna.
Thank you, George.
Let's get some facts on the table first. As DNC chair, you didn't have the power on your own to replace Hillary on the ticket.
No, but as you well know, the charter of the DNC, as well as the convention rules, say that the chairperson shall, in consultation with the leadership in Congress and others. And so I had to put it on the table, George, because I was under tremendous pressure after Secretary Clinton fainted to have a quote-unquote plan B. I didn't want a plan B. Plan A was great for me. I supported Hillary, and I wanted her to win, but we were under pressure.
So how serious was this? You write that you got a call from Vice President Biden at the time. Did you mention this to the Vice President?
No, I did not. I mean, look, everybody was calling to see, do you know anything? How is she doing? And of course, my job at the time, George, was to reassure people, not just the Vice President, but also reassure the Democratic Party, the members of the party, that Hillary was doing fine and that she would resume her campaign in the following week.
Do you still think that Biden and Booker would have won?
Well, you know, I had a lot of other combinations. This was something that you play out in your mind. But at the time, I was sitting next to Charlie Baker, who was her chief of
Clinton's campaign.
That's right. And Charlie and I put down, well, we had a lot of rumors coming. I had the former chair of the DNC calling me, Donald Fowler Jr., I mean, senior, what are you doing? Look, the bottom line is she resumed campaigning. I went on TV to say that the campaign was back on track.
As you can imagine, there's been quite a reaction to this, including this open letter from the Hillary for America 2016 team signed by about 100 people. They say they were shocked to learn that you were considering this, and they go on to say, it is particularly troubling and puzzling that she would seemingly buy into false Russian-fueled propaganda spread by both the Russians and our opponent about our candidate's health.
Well, George, at the time, like I said, I talked with Charlie Baker, but as it relates to that...
Did you mention this idea to him?
No, I kept my own counsel. I'm the chair of the party, George, and I decided I wanted to be up front with someone inside the campaign, and Charlie was there sitting across from me. But let me just address what my former colleagues... I wasn't a staff person. I did not work for the Hillary Clinton campaign. I was not only a daily strategy calls. I had nothing to do with their data analytics. I was the chair of the Democratic National Committee. I was concerned about the entire party, not just the presidential, but the senatorial, congressional, and all of the other
From the campaigns. Sound of it, it sounds like you had a pretty dysfunctional relationship with the high command in Hillary's campaign. You even talk about telling them at some point, I'm not Patsy the slave.
Oh, George, let me tell you something. I could not control the purse string of the Democratic Party. And I had to figure out what was going on within the party, that the chair of the party, and remember, I wasn't just a chair, I'm also a vice chair. I was an officer for 8 years. 8 years under President Obama. I knew what was going on within the party. I become chair and I'm trying to write a check for something. I raised the money and they're like, you gotta get signed off from Brooklyn. I said, Brooklyn? This wasn't a standard joint fundraising agreement. They had a separate memorandum of understanding and I needed to break that. But in order to break it, I would cause a great commotion. So, yeah, I'm not Patsy the slave because I got sick and tired of people telling me how to spend money when all I was trying to do, I wasn't getting a salary. I was basically volunteering my time. And what I was trying to do, George, was to increase the level of enthusiasm and passion for Hillary Clinton and the rest of the ticket all across the country.
They also take exception to your description of the campaign right now as an antiseptic, sterile campaign inside the headquarters. A lot of people saying that is not the campaign they knew.
Well, you know what? They should take a page from Hillary's book, take a look inside of what they did last year, and then they should write their own book. Hillary wrote a book, which I enjoy reading. It was part memoir. It was a history book. I love reading her book. If they don't like my book, don't buy it. But let me just say this. I have every right as a former chair of the party. Next year, I will celebrate almost 50 years in American politics. The Democratic Party is 170 years old.
I get that, but how do you respond? It's not just the Clinton campaign. You know, there's a lot of traffic on Twitter right now. I've gotten emails from Democrats,
I bet.
Passionate Democrats, who say they feel betrayed by all this. Any regrets?
Do I regret taking on a job the second time in my life as chair of the party, cleaning up everybody's mess, taking all of the incoming, being unable to spend funds that I raised? Do I regret being on the road 100% of the time, being hacked by the Russians, being harassed, getting death threats? Do I regret any of that? George, this was worse than Hurricane Katrina in terms of the emotional toll. But do I regret standing up for what's right, helping Hillary Clinton, helping the Democratic Party? And let me just say this, as somebody who went through the hacking experience, being able to tell the truth about what happened with the Russians, the attack on our government, do I regret any of that? No, I wish I could have done more, George.
But you think this helps for the book to come out?
Well, George, this is a lesson of 2016. If I released it next year, they would say, Donna, you're impacting on 2018. If I release it the fall, Donna, you're impacting. George, for those who are telling me to shut up, they told Hillary that a couple of months ago. You know what I tell them? Go to hell. I'm going to tell my story.
I want to tell my story, George, because this is a story of a young girl who started in American politics at the age of 9, who continues to fight each and every week of her life. I went down to Virginia last week to kick off the canvassing campaign. Nobody paid me to do that. Nobody, I'm not on the payroll, George. I care about my country. I care about our democracy. And I say go to hell because why am I supposed to be the only person that is unable to tell my story? Now, I've heard a lot of people tell me various things as well, but here's what they don't know. They don't know what it was like to be over at the DNC during this hacking. They don't know what it's like to bury a child. I did, Seth Rich. They don't know what it's like to protect the staff from further harassment. They don't know what it's like because the high command of Brooklyn, the people who were making the decisions, even for the DNC, they didn't come and work with us. They told us to shut up and basically let them win the election. And when we tried to intervene, we had to spend money we raised to try to help them win. And that was my job as chair of the party.
Pretty clear you have no regrets at all right there. You just mentioned Seth Rich, who, of course, was killed during the campaign. Did you feel under threat?
Every day, especially when Donald Trump, when Donald Trump would go out there and tweet. You know, look, I've worked on campaigns all my adult life. I've been called some of the worst things in America. But when Donald Trump would go out there and attack me, I got the threats were just unbearable. My house right now is, I got every different kind of security device. I had to get my home swept. I had to get the DNC swept twice. It was horrible.
As you know, he's tweeting again based on your book. Just the other day, he put out, the real story on collusion is in Donna B's new book, Crooked Hillary bought the DNC and then stole the Democratic primary from crazy Bernie.
Well, Donald Trump likes to distract. I mean, what Donald Trump should be focusing on right now is protecting our country from being hacked again. He should be working with Congress to ensure that the American people will feel confident that we are going to have a good election season in 2017, 2018. Donald Trump loves to distract us and divide us. I'm not playing this game.
He wants an investigation, the Department of Justice.
Well, I think he needs to look in his own house before he tries to clean up someone else's house.
Do you think this joint fundraising agreement was anything illegal at all?
As I said at the time, George, I did not like the fact that there was an additional memorandum that spelled out what the Clinton campaign could do in exchange for bailing the Democratic Party out. I give Secretary Clinton credit for bailing the Democratic Party out because we were in debt.
But I've seen the email traffic, and it appears from at least one email that the Sanders campaign was offered the exact same term. They could also negotiate an agreement of their own if they raise more money. They chose not to.
The Sanders campaign set up a joint fundraising account as well, but they chose not to put money in it. But they also chose to allow the DNC to control what little funds they did put in it. This was a separate, what this was an additional memorandum.
Right, but they were offered that same thing. Here's the email. If you're raising significantly more than the amount to cover the voter file for the DNC, DNC staff would be happy to chat with the Sanders team and come to an understanding about the best way to use those funds to prepare for the general election at the DNC. So they were offered a similar chance.
George, when I found out the reason why the chair of the party, the chair of the Democratic National Committee, could not spend the funds, I found the agreement myself. This is the agreement they put out. This is the agreement I found. And what I tried to do, George, was to work within the parameters of this agreement so that I could hire staff, so that I could spend money that we raised, and so that I could help Hillary and Tim Kaine and all of the other Democrats win. As for any agreements or side agreements they had with Senator Sanders, I've never seen that before, George.
Do you agree with Elizabeth Warren that the primaries were rigged?
I don't think she meant the word rigged, because what I said, George, as you well know, after I left this show back on July 24th, I said I would get to the bottom of everything. And that's what I did. And I called Senator Sanders to say, you know, I wanted to make sure there was no rigging in the process. I'm on the Rules and Bylaws Committee. I found no evidence, none whatsoever. The only thing I found, which I said, I found the cancer, but I'm not killing the patient, was this memorandum that prevented the DNC from running its own operations.
You also write about that email where you appear to share questions with the Clinton campaign from a debate
on
CNN. We're showing it up on the screen right now. And in the past, you said that sending those emails was a mistake. You'll forever regret, but in the book, it seems you're still not sure you sent this email.
Well, George, I mean, when you're hacked, I mean, look, I have seven email accounts, maybe
more. When you're hacked and you don't know, I'm the only person in America that had to go and look and say, okay, where is it? Where is it? I knew I'd sent emails. Of course, George.
So you're not denying that you sent this email?
George, I'm not. First of all, I said straight up, I said, look, if this was sent, I know why I sent it. I apologize. I spent the entire month of August apologizing for the leaked hacked emails, which is a crime. And so far, no one has been charged with the crime. But I've apologized. I said, I'm sorry. But here's what I also say in the book that I thought was very helpful to the reader, and that is to tell people during this time when we were under pressure to add more debates to the schedule, I went out to get more debates. Well, CNN was the beneficiary of those debates, but I wanted more diversity. I wanted more diverse voices. And yes, I wanted issues that people cared about. People were, as you recall, Black Lives Matter. They were marching in the streets. They wanted us to address criminal justice reform. And yes, when CNN agreed to go to Flint, Michigan, we wanted to have a conversation about the water crisis. All of that's in the memo. All of that's in the
book. Did you ever share questions with the Sanders campaign?
Let me tell you something, George, and I also have in a book that even on occasions when I knew the topics on ABC, I even talked to the Republicans about what the topics would be. I shared with everybody because, you know what, I wanted the best information possible. The second thing is I didn't want the candidates shocked by the nature of the questions. For the first time, we were going to go beyond, you know, talking about the usual issues that animate Democratic primaries, and we were going to talk about issues that concern Black Lives Matter.
You have some tough words for the leaders of your party in here in the book as well. And here's what you write. We've had three Democratic parties, the party of Barack Obama, the party of Hillary Clinton, and the weak little vestige of a party led by Debbie that was doing a very poor job getting people who are not president-elected. These three titanic egos, Barack, Hillary, and Debbie, have stripped the party to a shell for their own purposes.
Well, over 1,000 state legislative seats. And by the way, I take responsibility too, George. I'm a Democrat. We've lost thousands of state legislative seats. We've lost gubernatorial seats. But we have an opportunity on Tuesday in New Jersey and Virginia to fight back, to regain some of the lost ground over the last 10 years. And that's what I'm hoping will happen. Every voter should know out there that their vote counts. Their voice must be heard. I encourage them to get out and vote next week in Virginia and New Jersey and later on in Alabama. Well, I'll be in Alabama by the end of the month. It's important that everybody votes. Yes, I take a hard hit at people within the party because I love my party, I love my country, and I'm going to continue to fight for it.
Continue to fight for it. And are you confident now that the Democratic Party can be fixed? And what's the most important thing it needs to do?
Well, first of all, I am very confident that Tom Perez is leading in the right direction. We have a unity commission that is going to examine all of the things I raised about the primary contest and the caucus system. We have Keith Ellison and others who are energizing the grassroots. The party is making a substantial investment in the states. And, George, one of the things that bothered me, especially in the Patch of the Slave chapter, I got some controversial chapters, I understand. But anybody from Louisiana know that I'm going to put some hot sauce on every page. And if it's not dripping with something that's hot and spicy, it's not me. But, George, what I'm most confident of is that we now have a party that is investing in all 50 states. You know, imagine you're the chair of the party. I'm from Louisiana. I am from the South. And I cannot get one poster outside of Florida, Virginia, North Carolina to go home to Louisiana or Mississippi or Alabama. I can't send any resources to those states. I'm the chair of the party. And by the way, I didn't ask to be chair, George. When I left your show on July 24th, I thought I was getting ready to go out and have a nice brunch. Instead, I was called to say, Donna, we need you to step up again. And I did.